Hello everybody, this is Dr. Carlo, Medical Director. This is a review of the ED departmental meeting that happened early last week, January 2016. Time for review. I will be scheduling a one-on-one performance review with each of the providers, both doctors and advanced practice providers. I will be sending you a guide as to what the discussion will be so you can be prepared for it. The discussion is going to be based on productivity, patient perception scores, quality metrics, peer review, complaints, and your individual goals for this year, as well as chart completion, quality of charting, and things like that. Good news, we got two new hires on the APP side, Advanced Practice Providers. This is Derek Mix, a nurse practitioner who was a paramedic first and did nursing school and now is a nurse practitioner. Works in an ER of similar volume and work in a standalone ER prior to that. He has done already basic bootcamp and is halfway through the advanced bootcamp, so he's obviously well prepared. And Michael Witherspoon comes from Emory. He's was recruited kind of from Ms. Graff, so we know that his work ethic's very good. And they both beginning contract and a credential, and hopefully we can get him in by late March or April. And then Dr. Bui, he's an ER doctor with experience. He lives out of Marietta, is working in different hospitals, and he's accepted a full-time position as well. Delinquencies. First, I would like to thank you all for your efforts at completing your records timely. I used to get these big files with a bunch of incomplete charts and delinquencies, but now they're a few, only a few every time I get a file, except the very last file I got. And that's between the time I made this presentation. Now look how thick this paperwork file is, and list of patients after patients of charts that are pending or incomplete. So, you know, guys, you gotta make sure you finish your charts timely. They need to be done within 48 hours, 72 hours tops. That's just a normal part of your employment.
I think he needs emergency stuff.
However, some advanced practice providers still routinely take about 1 week or more to complete records at this time, and the goal should be about 48 hours. Let's talk a little bit about documentation, critical care documentation. You can see from October, November, December, the numbers have been going up as much as 2.2% of critical care documentation on patients. So although we have seen a steady improvement in the amount of critical care documentation, the national average is about 5%, so we're significantly under, and we're definitely seeing enough sick people that that shouldn't be the case. So just be aware that critical care is not just CPR and code blues. It includes the following. You can see on the right side of this table, anaphylactic shock. So if you give epinephrine for an allergic reaction, if you diagnose somebody with unstable angina, so they need nitrous, they need heparin, they need aspirin, that should be it. Obviously cardiac arrest, but severe COPDs, if they're on BiPAP, if you're doing blood gases and things like that, those are more critically ill patients. Anybody with a low glycerol coma score that needs multiple re-examination or exams. Obviously, anybody needing procedures like TPA, cardioversion, defibrillation, or something like that. PE in general is critical care unless they're completely stable and being discharged. Some hospitals do discharge PEs on Xarelto or something like that. Anybody you're diagnosing with severe sepsis, those are critical intervention, critical fluids, antibiotics, and things like that. On any unstable vital signs that need intervention, open bone fractures, and so on. Downcodes. The downcodes refers to when we could have billed for more money or a higher level of care, but because of the lack of documentation, we end up having to bill for a lesser code. That means that we gave services, but we weren't able to fully bill for those services. Out of all the providers, we got Dr. Gore, George Kahn, and Schaefer as the ones with the most amount of down codes, and from the APP side, Dupree and Galland. So you got to be careful with that. Most of those deficiencies usually are because of lack of review systems, or past medical history, social history are usually the big issues there. Post-splint documentation. This is another area in need of improvement. We are only documenting less than 1% of all splints that are placed in the ER. This is not only important because it increases our billing and productivity, but it also is a risk management issue. Document appropriate position of the splint, sensation, capillary refill, and neurovascular exam would certainly be better on a patient who comes back with a complication related to the splint or compartment syndrome. But if that documentation is not there, then the argument that this patient had the compartment and we didn't pick it up, it's a big issue. So approved added coverage. We finally got approved 6 more total hours of MD coverage. That means that once we have 2 more full-time MD providers, will be able to add this coverage every day of the week. As it is now, we don't have enough MDs to cover this, so we're going to play with those hours, and I'm going to leave that discussion for the end of this presentation. But we can start by adding coverage on some days of the week as people volunteer. We can add more hours to each shift, like making shifts 11 hours or even 12 hours as people volunteer to do that. Or we can try to convert some of those MD hours to mid-level hours and bring them in on different days. So what I do need is volunteers, some of you who can work extra hours. So if it's a Monday and you're coming for the 10 to 8 shift, what can you do a 9 to 8 p.m. instead? That's an 11-hour shift. If you're working the night shift and it's Sunday or Monday, which are usually very busy, can you come an hour early and work your shift? And be ready to stay late if it's really busy, because we have the hours, we need to use them. Ideally, we want to keep the schedule the same and just add a whole extra shift, like for example at 2 p.m. to midnight. So going over the schedule, look over the days that you are available that you could pick up an extra shift and let me know, and we can pencil you in for a whole extra shift. Now that's more than 6 hours per day, but as long as I stay under 42 hours per week, we'll be fine. Once Dr. Bowie gets credentialed, then we'll be able to do the additional doctor in the schedule, 3 days 1 week, 4 days the other, for an average of 12, 13 shifts that month. And of course, if he wants to pick up more, or anybody else wants to pick up more shifts, we can do that as well. Let's talk about stroke. First, congratulations to Dr. Ramey on being able to have a doctor to TPA time of 31 minutes. I mean, that's awesome. It's really hard to do. And obviously shows her dedication, her attention, and her treating a cold stroke as a true emergency. Dr. Gupta from Kenistone has agreed to take all of our TPA patients, so if you're given TPA, I would highly encourage you to start the transfer process right away. We need to evaluate every cold neuro patient within 10 minutes of that cold neuro being called, and you must give each of them 2 things, an NIHSS score and TPA candidate or not TPA candidate. If it's a TPA candidate, you need to treat that patient as a true stroke. You need like a code blue and constant and deliberate attention until the decision to give or not give TPA is made. The goal is to give the medication door to needle for 45 minutes. See, we only give this medicine about 1 time per month. We need to get the next 6 cases right under 45 minutes for our average to be down and for us to have a good evaluation with the code stroke joint commission comes to evaluate us. So I need you all guys to be on your very best behavior, treat every potential code neuro as an emergency, respond quickly, score them NIHS score, and whether or not they're TPA candidates. Window of mercy. For patients with very severe strokes, large scores of 8, more than 8, but less than 22 on the stroke scale, and more than 4.5 hours from the window for TPA, they can still be considered for what is called the window of mercy. There is still a time where you can do interventions on these patients. This has to be less than 12 hours, so large strokes. You can see a clot in CT scan, it's a large area of penumbra around the stroke, or patients who woke up with a stroke. These patients need a CT angiogram as soon as you identify them and begin the transfer process immediately. Let's talk about sepsis. We have seen a big improvement in our compliance with the highest ever this December at 70% with the sepsis bundle utilization. Still, our fallouts happen because of two major reasons. One, ordering the sepsis bundle, but not ordering the antibiotics. And number two, not having the vital signs when you're doing the medical screening exam, which means you don't know they're septic and you don't order the appropriate thing. So, if you have a patient who comes in with complaint of fever, you need to know if they have a fever at that time. You need to know if they're tachycardic before you go into your next patient. Whether or not that means you need to get the vital signs yourself, then you need to do that. You can't just order stuff like an x-ray and not know. I personally made misjudgments on how sick somebody is. Somebody cough, congestion, 3 or 4 days. They're tachypneic, they're a little tachycardic. They sound like pneumonia, but they look clinically well. So after I get an x-ray, they have pneumonia. I go check on them again. They don't look so hot. I get blood work, and now the lactic's up, their Wilkins up. So now they meet criteria for severe sepsis. And now I'm getting them admitted, and I missed the time windows for fluids and antibiotics for an appropriate complete sepsis bundle. So if I would have just have a higher sensitivity and a higher aggressive or urgency about it, I would have ordered the complete bundle right away, and this patient would have got the treatment they needed within the time period that's recommended. What's wrong? Nothing's wrong. Let's look at this graph right here. It's about patient perception. And I want you to look at the column there, the first blue column that says rank, Oprah Skinny database. And as you can see, there's a lot of blue, and then there's a rash of, or a series of red ones, and then blues again. You see those red ones? Those are, one is for nurses concerned for privacy, but all the others are about doctors. So that means the ER as a whole is doing better than the doctors. Or another way to say it is doctors are dragging these scores down. So let's look at this in more detail. Doctor's courtesy, 46th percentile. Doctor took time to listen, 26th percentile. Doctor informative about retreatment, 44th percentile. And doctor's concern for comfort, 37th percentile. So guys, we really need your help. I mean, we need to do deliberate attempts at bringing these scores up. It's not just doing what we do, status quo, being nice to patients, deliberate attention. For example, doctor took time to listen, 26th percentile. That means they're perceiving us as rushed, as not listening, as walking out on them. We need to sit down at the bedside and increase the perception of the time spent with them. Maybe take the computer to a room. Do the documentation in the room. You spend 3, 4, 5 minutes doing documentation, doing phone calls. I carry my portable phone, so I'm starting to do my phone calls from the room. I'm starting to do my documentation in the room, typing the discharge instructions in the room. That increases my face contact with that patient. Hopefully, the scores will follow. Conserve for comfort. We talked about this. You need to say something at least 7 times before the person actually catches it. So you need to say things. Are you comfortable? I'm concerned about your comfort. How's your pain doing? Can we bring you anything? Can I make you more comfortable? You gotta say that word 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times during the visit. So if we use it, if the techs use it, if the nurses use it, a total 7 times, that number should get better. Courtesy, reinformative to treatment. I've talked about this before. Use the board on the room. Put your name in, put what you're doing on it. This is communication, this is reinformative to treatment. When you go back to talk to the patient, bring copies of their lab work, printouts of their x-rays. This will help our scores. And not just because of the score is just a tool to know that we're not doing what we should be doing. What's important is that we're doing our very best for our patients. So attention to schedule change, we already kind of talked about this, but this is the bottom line. We want to increase the coverage. We have 6 hours a day, 42 hours per week that we can use. So initially, we can do longer shifts and get approved for that depending on how busy it is. Or we can do additional shifts of 10 hours as long as we don't go over 42 hours per day. So if you feel like picking up some extra shifts, contact me. We'll go over it and see where we can fit you in. And that's it for today. Bye.